When you're a teenager, you really have no clue what your identity is. You try so hard to find a place where you belong. What it's taught me, like what all these years have taught me, is just to like be myself. Once you understand that giving yourself is all you can do, it's so liberating. It really opens the barriers and lets you see the world in a wider perspective and meet new people and yeah, fully embody who you are.
Can you introduce yourself?
Where do I start? My name would be a good place to start. My name is Phoebe and I'm 17. I'm very nearly 18. I'm 18 on the 25th November. What else do you want to know about me? Hobbies? School subjects? All right, hobbies outside of school. I'm a composer. I mean, that's what I want to do for university, but it's also a hobby because I love it. And I write classical music and I write video game music and I write songs, and I like to listen to music. I can't really categorize my music taste. I listen to a lot of different stuff. My favorite band's Gorillaz. Well, one of them you can see on my shirt, Gorillaz. I like playing video games a lot, especially my favorite genres are first person shooter and point and click. Those are two genres I really like and I'm really good at. I like to knit, I like to collect vinyls, I like to do art. Yeah, that's my hobbies, I think. Alright, what next?
And music's your passion?
Music's my passion. It's what I like doing most, it's what I want to do for a living, hopefully, if I can make it.
Now, the strong thing about surrealism is it is expressionist in the sense that it hasn't got a home key. It doesn't make you feel at home. In films, when you watch films, like horror films, are made to not go back to the home key unless they want to trick you to feeling, I'm feeling comfortable. And then they shock you.
Yeah.
Okay? The false sense of like, oh, I'm home, I feel comfortable. And they trick you with home keys and stuff like that. This surrealism has no home key at all, so you don't feel comfortable at all throughout the whole journey. And that's why it's like strongly in the expressionist camp. Does that make sense?
It just feels like, you know, you're applying formulas to music, but it doesn't have a soul to it. It feels like more like an execution of a concept than an expression of intent and meaning.
That just proves my point. Like,
yeah,
that,
exactly.
Like, this
concept,
you have to train, you have to like actually make it sound good. Like, What really gets me is, like, it's not that it's applying a mathematical formula to music. There's math rock, which sounds absolutely great and soulful and stuff. It's that, like, a computer could generate this, and it would sound no different to something that a human wrote. It would sound just as artificial and soulless.
You're not going to make art by, you know, writing down a times table over and over again in different colours. You're going to make art by, you know, picking a concept, painting out the concept. Even if it's abstract, like, you can try and do execute something with an abstract concept.
Although it could have a meaning, it could mean something completely different to someone else. And I feel like art really is just like a tool that reflects on the individual can just be seen as like a pretty object, or there can be like a deeper meaning to it depending on, you know, the person. And I feel like there's no problem with either one. And I feel like that's very special. I lost my grandma back in January of last year, so during lockdown, and she lived in Ireland. And so I wasn't able to see her, and I attended her funeral via Zoom, which was just really surreal. I painted a picture of her room, and it had like all these significant objects that I thoroughly remembered from that time. It was quite bare, it was quite desaturated in colour, but then on the sofa there's like a shadow, and that's where she'd always sit. And it kind of was supposed to represent that, you know, although she's passed, like a part of her will always like remain in this physical world. And on that sofa where she'd always sit. It's very different from my old school, like very much so, definitely in a positive way. It's a lot more liberal and freeing, and less, I guess, it has less of a repressive atmosphere. I think students are encouraged to express themselves in any way or form.
Something like a bit of fish, dry fish. Find something in a
harbor thing.
In a grocer's. Something like, you know, where they dry things? You get bits of dry fish.
Or you can just slice an apple.
Something which has a little bit of an aroma to it. Yeah, your manifesto is all about dangerous reality and all that. I think you need a bit of, need something which has a little bit of a pong to it.
Okay.
Yeah, if you go to like an Oriental supermarket, things like Bombay duck. Isn't Bombay duck kind of dried fish or something? Something like that.
And put it in my book.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just like a bit of it, just a little bit of it, just so that, because all these are imitating, you know, skin and dried flesh.
Yeah.
To have a little bit of something actual.
I mean, that's
actual.
Like actually taking my own skin.
Yeah. Well, that might be a little bit risky.
It is a personal experience, and I like art being a personal experience. And finding home in London too, like, home was in Lima for me, so how do I feel here, exploring if I feel at home, if I don't, if I feel happy or don't.
I mean, you could do something like that. You know, you put it there to get rid of it again.
Tie a road across. What would you like to do later in your life?
Actually, I kind of want to have a school. Yeah, an art school. And go back to Peru maybe and open a school there. Or not maybe as I open a school, but be in a place where art, like this school, basically. So I want to work somewhere like this place.
My mum and sister, they've always been quite creative. My sister did lots of art. My mum and her side of the family, my grandma, they were all very in tune with the artistic side. And me and my dad, we just like, we couldn't do anything creative, if you would. But I think that once I got a taste of drama in year 10, like just something kind of unleashed in me. And I just wanted to just do more all the time. Once I come into somewhere that there's no right or wrong, there's just lessons. I think it just relieved a lot in me. Like, I didn't feel as stressed having to do work or, you know, as stressed having to sit down and feel so boxed. It definitely made me feel more free and more willing to do work.
Okay, please, I'd like you to do the safe scene now. This time, I want you to change the tempo rhythm. So this time, what happens to that scene if you play it really fast? So you have a very fast external tempo rhythm where everything's moving very quickly, but also inside you're feeling there's a very fast tempo rhythm being played out as well. So So what happened to that scene? So do the same scene, but what happens if you just change it? So you've got two scenes.
When I was given the opportunity to be another character and just completely detach from who I am and Hannah's life story and Hannah's past and Hannah's emotions, it gave me kind of so much freedom to be allowed to take away from your own life for an hour or 20 minutes performing something, you know, be able to let out like real life emotions that you couldn't necessarily do in the real world for whatever reason, whether that's upsetting someone or you don't know how to like express them in the moment when I'm acting, wherever I am, I channel like the emotions that I feel like are stuck down below. The main goal's like an actress. It's a bit far-fetched, but I just can't see myself not doing that.
I'm very grateful that it's an art form that's there, because I don't really think I fit into like the biology or the maths and things like that. Like, I do understand why people like those subjects, they're great subjects, but to create stories and to have people really feel for these characters and the situations they're in, and really see themselves in these people from your mind, it's just amazing. So I just knew I had to be part of it, yeah. In many films, there's always a one-sided villain where they're just evil for the sake of being evil. But I believe doing sociology will teach me how to write characters and direct characters who are villains, to be understood by the audience of why they're doing, why they have such nefarious plans, and why they're treating our heroes or protagonists the way they are, because they've had experiences in life different from our protagonist. So that outlet from sociology will teach me how to write better characters.
If Mariam is able to see these, you know, beautiful, attractive, modern women in their suits with their, you know, walking with purpose.
And she was like,
what does this reveal to us about Kabul in the 1960s and 70s?
It's a lot more freedom.
Exactly.
It's good, absolutely.
It's a free, liberal, modern city, okay? Not the Afghanistan that we see in the media, okay? So you have to remember that and make sure that when you talk about Mariam's, you know, youth, Mariam's marriage, that you're not talking about the Soviets or the Taliban or the Mujahideen, okay? There are ways of talking about that. What horrible thing happens to Mariam in this part of the novel? A number of horrible things happen.
Miscarriages,
good. What else?
Abuse,
yes. The start of the abuse. And how is that characterised? How is that shown to us? What's
when
the first abuse?
The pebbles.
When she's forced to eat the pebbles. What else? What happens after Nana's death?
Everyone has different experiences. And it's understanding them on a level is what helps us like move forward as people and a society. So putting that into our art and into what we enjoy and expressing that to the world can really help us progress as a society.
I don't ask for Christmas. There is just one thing I need. I don't care about the presents underneath the Christmas tree. 'Cause I just want you for my own, more than you could ever know. Make my wish comes true. With a toy on a Christmas day, 'cause I just want want you for my own, more than you could ever know. Make my wish come true, baby, all I want for Christmas is you.
Merry Christmas, Happy New Year.
Asking the question, what lies behind all of our judgments? And one way you can ask the question is this: do we love something because it's good, or do we call something good because we love it?
We call something good because we love it.
Okay, good. So this is the key. This is the key difference. I'm going to come back to you on that and ask you to justify it. My question to you is: would everyone agree on abortion or euthanasia?
No.
So everyone would agree. I'm pretty sure there's no one in the world, whatever country they were in, whatever culture they were in, who would debate with us about whether this was a computer keyboard or not. We'd all agree on that.
My dad would find a way.
Okay. Apart from Gigi's dad. We'd all agree in a different languages, different cultures, this is a keyboard for a computer, right? But if I said, and therefore we know that the questions about what this is are objective. They're not about what you feel about it or think affected your emotions. They're about objective facts. But if I said euthanasia is good or bad or abortion is good or bad, immediately we'd have different feelings and different opinions. Now, that seems to be evidence for the idea that we call something good not because it's good, but because we love it, because it's how we feel about it.
That's right. Look at Greta Thunberg, poor girl, she's literally like 16, 17, she's like our age, and she is screaming at these adults about our end that is so visibly in the road, and like everything that has scientific evidence backing up points that is happening, and nothing has changed. Now, she's been around for like 3 years, she's been doing this since she was young, and no one is listening to her. I don't know whether that's because she's a girl, I don't know whether it's because she's young. There's so many sexist and ageist reasons as to why the adults in politics won't listen to her. But I think, in a sense, she's made me realise that there is only so much you can do to unify people.
So the question is, why isn't there a set answer?
There's different upbringings, there's different people, different cultures, all different things that come together to sort of formulate different people's opinions.
Okay, so we're going to call that's got a word.
Once again, everything, I might as well show you, but I'm planning to get rid of all of this because it just doesn't go as well. It doesn't even work with the music anymore. The plan was for her to see her love interest and like be like, whoa, who's that?
But then I think I don't film it properly, and the girls are like really oversaturated. Oversaturated, overexposed. I mean, like they look too bright.
I feel like it didn't throw me off, but it made it really feel like work, if you understand what I mean. Like I feel like I've always had like a positive thinking to making movies, which I still do, but it's become like, whoa, okay, it's actually a job. Like I get why film directing is a job, being a producer, job, cameraman, whatever. Because like as much as it's fun, as much as you enjoy it, you know, if things aren't in place for you to make it, you won't reach your end goal. I've enjoyed the new things that I learned. Like I made my first film because of this school. In my last school, I still would not have made anything because they didn't do, even they did media, but we didn't make films in that class. It was more about like computer coursework. Okay, so the Big Idea Challenge run by London Met University, and they go to 10 different schools, and we had to come up with an idea. Our idea was to make an app which told you about activities in your area that you can do. We felt like this idea would be good because we feel like because of COVID, teenagers have struggled of like things to do when they go out. So we came up with that idea, and our idea was picked as the best idea within the school. So because of that, we were then selected to go to the NatWest headquarters in central London. And then we pitched our ideas with other schools around. Even though it's not like, you know, the strongest prize, I'm still very happy with what we got, because, you know, I feel like the people's vote speaks more than, you know, the judges' vote.
So you won the people's vote?
Yeah, we won the people's vote, and we're very happy about that. We were surprised, but happy. Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Feminist art historians started re-looking at images historically with a kind of a question about it. Why would anyone question this image, do you think?
She has her like hand over her breast, she's like covering all her like...
Yes, absolutely. So there's a kind of, do you think she's aware anyone's looking at her?
No.
So there is a word that we can use.
Voyeurism.
Excellent, voyeurism. There's an agreement in the life room that there's a certain activity going on where that's okay, but you wouldn't have that in any other part of life, would you? So I think this idea of relationships of looking and viewpoints and what that means is a really interesting thing to think about. Okay, and if you're going to use the figure in the future, these are questions always to ask.
Basically, it's like, I mean, I've sent in my university applications, but I'm just waiting on a call back from them to see if I get an interview or not. So I'm having to prepare, like, what I need to do for the interview, which is, I mean, for conservatoire, it's basically just a whole lot of music theory, studying composers, making sure, like, I'm very sure of myself and what I want to do, but it's just a lot of preparation, and I'm constantly, like, doing fake interviews on myself. What if they ask me an opinion on, like, a composer that I've barely like kind of gotten into, like I know Prokofiev, for example, like I know the great works, but I don't know like in depth what his style is, what his influences are, and I couldn't say what my favourite piece is by him. Stuff like that I get worried about.
So you're doing psychology, and what else are you doing?
History of art.
Okay. So history of art has constantly different perspectives and different views of art that changes. You know, the views change over the years, and so. And psychology is obviously about that too. What is your reason for wanting to do this? Are you aware of that? That there's something that you feel like you don't agree with certain people's views, you're aware of having a different viewpoint, or?
Well, I think we have quite a lot of debates in psychology about people's stance on different situations and things like that, which I find very interesting. And then in relation to perception, so I have auditory processing disorder.
Right.
So, like, I quite like the idea of, well, I was looking at some of, like, people who have synesthesia and the kind of the way that they see or hear colours. For me, it's, like, the way I process words is extremely different. So, I don't know, just that kind of that everyone has. We're all looking, like, at what we think is the same world, but we all are looking at it slightly differently.
Yeah. So what happened today?
Today I finished my A-levels. My philosophy A-level.
And how do you feel about that?
Really relieved, because these past few weeks have been probably, like, just some of the worst weeks of my life, to be honest. Really stressful. Ended on a really, like, hard note, because the exam was, like, probably the hardest exam that I've done so far. But honestly, like, I'm just gonna let it go and enjoy these last few weeks. I'm really pleased that I, like, started really early, because I get to finish really early, because most people have, like, 2 more weeks left. So I'm probably just gonna make art and stuff like that.
So I applied to Chelsea UAL, Camberwell, the Slade, Edinburgh and Manchester. And I got offered a place, and this is all degree, and I was offered a place at Chelsea, Camberwell and Manchester, and I was put on the waitlist for the Slade. I'm definitely a lot more confident in myself and also my work. I think, again, that's just because of, like I said, the education and care. Because, again, if I was at my old school, I would not have had the confidence to have just applied to a degree course straight from A-level. I would have had to just do a foundation, because I just wasn't confident in my work at all. And I've just made such lovely friends here that are so talented and creative as well, and it's so nice to be in, like, a environment with incredibly creative and passionate people in your circle. And I feel like just from that, something that I didn't have this much at my old school has really, again, like, boosted my confidence.
I started off the year with red hair and eyebrows, and I'm finishing off the year with no eyebrows and black hair. Like, I feel a very physical change in the way I'm comfortable with expressing myself. This school has really helped not shape me, but allow me to be more comfortable with shaping myself. And I'm very grateful for that, because I've still got another year here, so I can only imagine by the time this year, like next year this time, what I will look like and what I will be feeling with my confidence. And, you know, now in the summer, I want to go away and I want to bring a book with me and I want to write and I want to draw what I see and, like, look at the colour palettes of things and look at the lines in the road or the buildings I'm looking at. Like, I want to go to museums. I want to do things that enrich me a lot more, and it's 100% because of the subjects I'm taking.
So definitely, I think first, obviously, UCL is my top choice. I want to be in that environment. It's so international. I think it's a good place for me, because it's academic, but you also have other things going on. London, international people. Hopefully that. And I'm excited that happens.
I'm really grateful for how patient they've been with me, really understanding, helping me through my, like, learning difficulties and maybe not me understanding the whole concepts full, and really, like, sitting down and explaining it to me, or finding other outlets that can really benefit me and help my education. And I feel like many other schools would have just, like, given up, but here, they stayed like true and really tried to help me through my problems. So I'm very grateful for that.
I got into Royal Academy, Trinity Laban, and Guildhall, and I accepted Guildhall. Those are the conservatoires I got into. So I'm very happy with that, and I'm really happy I got the Guildhall. What's it called? They gave me a scholarship at Guildhall, so on top of that, that's really nice. I got the finalist for Young Composers Award, where the finals was hosted in York. I composed and performed one of my own pieces for cello recently. I'm now a finalist in this new Guildhall competition. So since we've been filming only 1 year, I can say like the last year's been especially fantastic. But then considering I've been here since year 10, really, there's much more of a focus on individual creativity and organic kind of production rather than, you know, just churning out the grades. And it feels like the teachers genuinely care about you as a person, and as well, the size of the community at the school is something I've always liked. It feels like everyone knows everyone. You can just say hi to anyone and get a hi back.
And are you excited for the future?
Very. New chapter in life, hey? And it's going to be at my place of choice. And it's going to be studying what I like most. So what's that not to be excited about? So yeah, it's sad leaving stuff behind, but there's so much to look forward to.
It's nice that you're still up here working, yeah. Even after finishing everything.
Yeah, no, that was like the first thing I thought of when I finished. I was like, I need to make something now.
And what's next for you then?